Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
I was on the flight between Philadelphia and Berkeley with Srila Prabhupada when the captain of the jet came out of the cockpit. He sat down next to Prabhupada and the two of them had a very animated, joyful discussion. You can see Prabhupada was relishing the conversation. So I was filming this and I was curious what they were discussing, but of course I couldn't hear it. And I was too shy to ask Prabhupada, you know, what did you talk about after it was over? So I resigned myself that I guess I wouldn't know. But it turned out that when Prabhupada arrived in Berkeley, during his arrival address, he mentioned the conversation. And he said the captain was very intelligent, and he asked several questions. One of the questions was, if God is all good, then why is there evil in the world? And Prabhupada said, for God, there is no evil. There's only good. And he gave the analogy, just as my back is as important to me as my chest. If there's pain in my back, I take care of that. I don't ignore it, thinking that the chest is more important. So evil is like the back of God, and it's not different from his front, which is compared to goodness. And then the captain asked, if everything is good from God's point of view, how can there be evil? And Prabhupada gave another example. He said it's like the sun. On the body of the sun, there's no shadow. We create shadow by turning our back to the sun. So similarly, evil means when we turn away from God. So then the captain asked a third question. He said, how is it possible to attain peace? And Prabhupada said, to attain peace, we have to understand that God is the supreme proprietor, the supreme enjoyer, and the supreme friend.
You know, there was another time with captains and airplanes also I can tell you about. We were between Bombay and Calcutta, and the pilot invited us in to the cabin. And even when we landed, we stayed there. We didn't even have seatbelts on anything. We just flew right into Calcutta. The pilot was showing everything to Prabhupada about the controls and how he flew the plane. And then Prabhupada turned to me and he said, it's just like typing. After a while, you learn how to move your fingers, because the pilot was going this and that and moving his fingers everywhere and switching switches. Because they switch switches a lot up there. They're not just sitting there. They're really doing things. And I was watching him. He turned to me and said, you can learn how to fly. I said, me fly? I'm afraid of heights.
I had attended the University of California here at Berkeley in the early 60s. And I remember there's so much anxiety with student rebellions and riots, and the drug scene was exploding at the time. And most students, including myself, were just dissatisfied and bewildered. Regularly, students were committing suicide by jumping off the clock tower we see in the background. When Srila Prabhupada was informed about this, his response put my whole university experience into perspective. And he told the story of the Himalayas giving birth. So many people gathered at a cave at the base of these huge mountains and then waited for days. And finally the mountains rumbled and the people only saw some rats run out of the cave. Everyone laughed, and then Bahulaspa told Prabhupada that I had graduated from this university. And Brahmananda said, oh, poor Yadubara. And I stepped forward and said, yes, Srila Prabhupada, I am one of those rats.
I joined the Los Angeles Temple in 1975. And the day that I joined, they put about, it seemed like about 100 devotees on the back of a flatbed truck covered with a tarp and We all drove to San Francisco for Ratha Yatra. I was new bhakta. I wasn't shaved up yet. I had long hair and a beard. I didn't really know much at all. So we were engaged helping to set up the festival, and we slept under the stage, the main stage. And the next day in the morning, we drove over to the Berkeley Temple for greeting of the deities, and Prabhupada came out around that same time, and all the devotees just pay their obeisances. And remember the first time I saw Srila Prabhupada, when he came out, it was just, I guess a lot of devotees have said this, but it was really like the room just lit up from his presence, although he was pretty slight in stature, but just this amazing effulgence came from him. And I remember thinking, boy, this person is really powerful. And then I thought, I hope he's good, because anyone with that kind of potency, it'd be pretty scary if he wasn't. Of course, I found out he was more than good later on.
I'm sitting in the temple room, Prabhupada's sitting in the Vyasasana, he's being interviewed by the news media. The question is, what will happen to your movement when you die? Before the words were out of his mouth, it was so lightning quick, Prabhupada was saying, I will never die. Right back at the guy. And we're like, and then Prabhupada explained himself, I will live forever in my books.
This was in the middle of the Inconceivable Marathon, so Ramaswar had arranged that the BBT staff, they're on a special bus that arrives right before the Ratha Yatra and takes off right after. So I remember I just would look at Prabhupada and kept staring at him and praying, how can I be of some service to you? Because I was feeling that I was just useless and missing out on all the nectar and not having anything to do for Lord Chaitanya's mission. Well, here I was, you know, working on the book marathon, but still, those were my sentiments. And I was lost in the crowd, and just looking up at Prabhupada and praying like that, very emphatically from my heart. And I'll never forget, all of a sudden, amidst hundreds upon hundreds of devotees, Prabhupada suddenly looked in my direction and looked straight at me, and I was so shocked. He just looked straight at me and fixed his eyes straight on me. I had no doubt what was going on. I was like, just stunned, like, my God, he actually knows what's going on in my heart.
Jayananda had said these wheels of the chariots are all wearing out, and they're dangerous, and they're too big, and they're too heavy, and we need to replace them. He wanted to make steel wheels with spokes, so he had this welder making new wheels. And the night before the Ratha Yatra, we went and put new wheels on Jagannath's chariot and Balaram's chariot, not on Subhadra's chariot. Her chariot was relatively easy to navigate compared to the other two. So we pulled the chariots, testing the new wheels, and there was no problem. The next morning, of course, the parade starts, and as soon as we started pulling the chariots, these new wheels collapsed. Instead of being round, they became octagons. Between each spoke, steel collapsed. So the chariots were bouncing, and I was horrified because the vibration was so intense. Fortunately, Srila Prabhupada was on the Subhadra's cart. But what was remarkable is that I had written Srila Prabhupada and told him that we were making new wheels. And he had written me back and said, the old wheels are fine. Don't change anything. This is your American disease. But by the time he'd gotten the letter, the old wheels had already been thrown away and the new wheels were done. So Jayananda reassured me, said, no, there's no problem. But then it was like Prabhupada's words had to be fulfilled. So as soon as that parade started, the new wheels collapsed. And I could hear Prabhupada's voice say, stick with the old way.
The other thing that I remember is, upon arrival at the festival site, Radha Balava, who was in charge of the production at that point, brought Prabhupada a stack of books, which had just been printed, because this was during the Inconceivable Marathon, so some books had already started to come out. And Prabhupada took those books And I'll just never forget what I saw. He was on the stage, seated on his Vyasasana, and I was down below, seated on the grass. And I saw Prabhupada just light up like the moon in the sky upon getting those books in his hand. And I'll never forget that. Then I remember him lecturing, and I remember him saying, I've given this example so many times. You water the tree at the root, all the branches blossom. You put the food in the mouth, the whole body's energized. And I remember at that moment, I finally caught it. It just finally dawned on me, the utter simplicity yet profundity of Krishna consciousness in bhakti yoga. Simply by satisfying Krishna, all purposes are fulfilled.
On the way down from L.A. to San Diego, Jayatirtha was falling asleep driving, so Prabhupada wouldn't let him drive anymore. So Jayatirtha got me to drive him 1 hour drive, but of course in those days, none of us slept much. So I remember I'm driving, I'm about halfway down. I look in the back, Prabhupada, his head tilted back, he was asleep. A few minutes later, I think it was Brahmananda sitting beside him, he was asleep. Jayatirtha sitting shotgun, I looked over at him a few minutes later, he was asleep. And I was like going through all these things to keep my eyes open. And I was like pinching myself and doing all this stuff. I was falling asleep with my eyes open. And all of a sudden, I hear this. And Prabhupada starts the kirtan. And then gradually, all the others woke up in the car, and we had this really nice kirtan, the four of us in the car. He led the kirtan.
Srila Prabhupada went on a tour of the temple, and I walked with him, and he, of course, went to the temple room first and offered his obeisances. I never forget, he walked in every room. He was inspecting everywhere. And the last room he went in was the Sankirtan room where all of his books were stored. When he saw his books were being taken care of and respected, he was so pleased, he grabbed me in his arms and embraced me and he said, thank you very much, thank you very much. And I fell at his feet offering dandavats and said, thank you, Srila Prabhupada. That was the fulfillment of all desires, to see Srila Prabhupada smile at me.
San Diego is a beautiful place where the sun always shines. They had a very large poster that used to be displayed in Los Angeles, a billboard showing a man on a golf course with the green grass and the blue sky. The caption was, just another beautiful day in San Diego. So that's San Diego, a place where it's perpetually beautiful and the people are perpetually mellow. And life is perpetually wonderful. And Prabhupada arrives on a beautiful summer day to address the people who had gathered for the Hare Krishna festival in Balboa Park. And they're basking in the sun, and there's these young demigods with bronze chests and beautiful blonde hair hanging down from their aristocratic, beautiful faces. And Prabhupada gives this lecture about this rotten material body. And it was just so perfect. It was just the dart in the hearts of these conditioned souls misidentifying themselves with the material nature.
Prabhupada was starting off speaking about one subject, and then a hippie interrupted him. I want sex! And Prabhupada just changed the whole subject of the lecture and began to explain in detail the grihastha regular principles for having children. It's quite astonishing. Telling the hippie, you can have, but this is the way you have it. Then after he spoke, there was this wonderful kirtan.
There's Govardhan, he's the temple president. And I'd actually just taken an initiation in June, so this is like a month later. I was actually here when Prabhupada came in, but I'm not here because I'm out at the curb with the car, And we had a nice white Lincoln Continental that we got from Ford Motor Company. We filled it with marigolds. I mean, it was just chock-a-block full with marigolds. And then when Srila Prabhupada came out, I offered my obeisances to him and held the door open. And he gave me a nice pat on the shoulder. I always remember that. And got in and we took off for the temple. I was Srila Prabhupada's driver for his whole visit in Detroit. When you drive from the airport into the city, you pass Ford Motor Company is on both sides of the road as you're coming in. And there's actually this big tire that's been there for years. It came from the World's Fair, I think. In 1964, they had a World's Fair. And they had a Goodyear exhibit. So they brought this huge tire. So we're passing this big, huge tire, and Prabhupada says, Srila Prabhupada had a great sense of humor. He said, oh, this is the presiding deity of Detroit. And we drove a little farther, and here's the car here. There I am. So we drove a little farther, and you know, we passed Ford Motor Company on the left and on the right, World Headquarters, Ford Motor Company, it said. So Brahmananda said, is this where you work? And Prabhupada said, you know, in his very deep voice, he said, no, he is the proprietor. So we all had a good laugh at that. And then we proceeded on to the temple. We were still at the Temple on Jefferson. Temple on Jefferson is in a historic neighborhood, Indian Village it's called. And we would go out to Belle Isle to go for a morning walk. It's a park near the temple on Jefferson, so we would go out there and park and then walk around. And it was my job to find the proper route. And no matter what route I ever came up with, we'd always run into a bunch of rowdy people or something. It was just, you know, because it's a city park, so the caliber of people in there were not so great. There'd be some people that had been there all night, rolling out of the bushes. But Prabhupada was very merciful, and, you know, I think he enjoyed walking there. The devotees had built Prabhupada a palanquin because the temple room was on the third floor. So they had built a palanquin to carry Prabhupada up to the top. And he took one look at it and waved his hand and said, no, no, because it didn't look very, very safe. We would come back to the temple room for greeting of the deities. And there is Radha Kunjabihari Jai. Govardhan was such a perfectionist that, you know, they were never ready by the time we got back. So, you know, we'd be standing out in front of the curtain with Prabhupada. I could hear Govardhan screaming in the back, forget it, forget it! You know, just get the curtain open on time. But he always did such a nice job dressing the deities. I think Radha Kunjabihari were famous for their opulence and also the opulent prasadam and milk sweets that you got. We used to just steal the Mangal Arati sweets after Mangal Arati and go into Govardhan's office and eat them. Govindam Hari Purusham Tamaham Jamin Govindam Hari Purusham Tamaham Jamin
Prabhupada came to greet the deities and he sat on the Vyasasan and nobody was doing Guru Puja. And I had never done Guru Puja before for Srila Prabhupada, and I'm not the type of person that jumps in on things. I always tend to let other people do it. But I was right next to the Vyasasan, so Brahmananda just came and kind of pushed me over to the arti tray. So that was the first and last time I was able to offer Guru Puja for Prabhupada. But the experience I had was that it was like there was no puja going on and Prabhupada was sitting in a room by himself. There were probably close to 200 devotees in the kirtan glorifying Prabhupada, and I was worshiping him. But the way Prabhupada was taking it
was as if none of that was going on. I didn't see any, what we could say, relish of being in that position, or any kind of desire or inclination to take advantage of that position. It was as if nothing was going on in the room. I was doing the puja. He was looking, he would look around, kind of observe what's going on with the devotees, more that he was looking after them. And this glorification is going on, and he's just taking it in for our benefit.
Summer of 75, we're on one of the Radha Damodar buses. Adikesha was the head of the bus, and we decided to follow Prabhupada around as much as we could. So we came to Detroit. The temple room was up in the attic. We converted the attic to a temple. Aviram, myself, some other devotees. Nobody knew how to do drywall taping at the time. So we had put all this drywall up, and when we were trying to figure out what to do, a young man showed up. And what do you do? Oh, I do drywall taping. So he stayed, taped the whole temple room, stayed when Prabhupada came, and then left, just like that. Krishna sent someone to help us out. Some gentleman had come to see Prabhupada, and he was someone who knew all the big auto barons and the history of Detroit, and he discussed that with Prabhupada. And he seemed to be very happy just to meet, a great personality like Prabhupada. Prabhupada didn't preach to him, just listened to what he said. It's very cordial. I was sitting in the room, a brahmacharya, and I thought Prabhupada was supposed to preach to everybody. But Prabhupada didn't preach to him at all. Prabhupada was just very nice and cordial, listened, asked a few questions. And I realized later that Prabhupada's a good judge of time and circumstance. This person wasn't into anything about spiritual life. He just liked to meet great people, famous people. And he came and met Prabhupada, the most famous person.
We did some programs also at the University of Michigan. Because I was a driver, I wanted to get Prabhupada as close to the door as I could. So one time I drove through these bushes and over the grass and everything to get Srila Prabhupada to the door of the auditorium. Brahmananda was sitting in the back. He's saying, "You can't do that just because you're a Ford." And I said, "No, it's not because of that." I said, "Because I have Prabhupada in the back seat. I feel I can bend the rules a little bit to try to get him as close to the door as possible." Prabhupada was laughing. He thought it was funny. But we had some nice programs at University of Michigan. And Prabhupada was just on his world tour. But at the same time, we were getting ready to buy a new temple. And Govardhan had gone out and scouted around and had found what is now the Bhaktivedanta Cultural Center, this historic mansion, the Fisher Mansion, which was in this very, very dilapidated part of town. East Jefferson, it's called. And it was, ghetto and just horrible. But the property itself was quite nice, and it was being sold. So we took Srila Prabhupada over there. The man who owned it owned an alarm company, so he had rigged the whole house up to test his alarms, and he had dogs and carpeting, and it was really moochy. So I was not all that impressed because it was dark and oppressive, and it was just scary. It was a scary place. And, I was not all that impressed by it. But we walked into the ballroom that Mr. Fisher used to have his parties in. And at the far end of the ballroom were three arches behind which the orchestra used to sit to play for the people when they came to the dance. So Srila Prabhupada saw these three arches and he said, "Oh, Krishna has made this house for us." So we all walked around and looked at the mansion here, there. And, Prabhupada asked what they were asking, and, they were asking $350,000, and Srila Prabhupada said, "Just to us, not to the realtor. Every room is worth $350,000. And then as we were walking out, Govardhan said, "How do you like this house, Srila Prabhupada?" And Prabhupada said, "Who would not like?" So Govardhan, I don't know why he said that, he said, "Well, Ambarish doesn't like it," because I had expressed some reservations about it. I was a new devotee, and I said, "Prabhupada, it's like Maya. When you're new, you think you know a lot more than you actually do." So Prabhupada said, "Yes, Krishna is Maya too. This can be utilized for Krishna's service too." Prabhupada saw everything as being able to be utilized in Krishna's service as principle of yukta vairagya, which I didn't know very much about then. Also, Prabhupada said if Krishna comes here, the neighborhood would change, because I had expressed some reservations. This is a high-crime neighborhood. Actually, the first carjacking in the United States took place there. So I had some reservations about crime and what was going to happen to the devotees, etc. And Prabhupada said, you just bring Krishna here and distribute prasadam, then everything will change. I just surrendered. So we decided that we would make an offer for the house. So the next day, Govardhan, myself, and Srila Prabhupada, we went back to the house, back to the Fisher Mansion, and we had a meeting out by the pool with the real estate lady, our broker, and the owner of the house. We all sat down, and the first thing that Srila Prabhupada said was, we are mendicants, so we would like it if you would give us this house. So the real estate lady, she almost fell in the pool, and because she saw her commission fly out the window. And, you know, the owner of the house, his jaw dropped, because I could tell what was going on in his head, that he was looking at Prabhupada and thinking, well, maybe he's a mendicant, but this guy over here looking at me, we definitely know he's not a mendicant, because he knew who I was. So anyway, he said, no, I'm sorry, I can't do that. And so he was asking $350,000, and Srila Prabhupada agreed to pay $300,000. So we got this beautiful historic mansion with all this work that really can't be replicated. I mean, that house, to replace it, would cost probably $5-10 million. So we got it for $300,000. So everybody was happy. Lekha Shabanti, she was Walter Ruther's daughter, and she basically surrendered everything. She gave everything she had to buy this house, and whatever she couldn't cover, I covered. So it was about 50-50. She was very surrendered, and I really commend her for that, because she sacrificed everything for Prabhupada. That night, I remember the real estate lady, she was a middle-aged Polish woman, and her friend came over to kind of congratulate Prabhupada that they'd accepted the offer. So they came up to Prabhupada's room. Both of them were intoxicated. So they were kind of rolling around on the pillows in front of Prabhupada's desk. But he was so jolly, because he was happy that we had purchased this house. And he was so kind to these old ladies. That was Prabhupada's nature, was that he could see everybody's spiritual identity, and he was very merciful to them. So we ended up purchasing the house, and that was a momentous occasion during that trip. We had our grand opening in 1983, I think it was. And since that time, there's been redevelopment all around the whole mansion, and people have told us, actually, that the reason that they came in there and put money into the area was because the Fisher Mansion was there and was being maintained so nicely by the devotees. So Srila Prabhupada could see past, present, and future, and could see that this was going to be very successful and become a very famous place. But it was really wonderful to have Prabhupada there. I remember it very sweetly. And of course, I had my personal service driving Prabhupada around. It was very nice, just after having been initiated. I'll always remember that trip.
Prabhupada spoke, then Prabhupada went to the airport, and we all went to the airport with Prabhupada, and I decided I had to get, like, close to Prabhupada, and I had to, like, get a glimpse or something from Prabhupada. So many devotees were there, and Prabhupada was walking through the corridors up to the lounge where he would take his flight from. And I remember I pushed my way through the devotees, and I came right up next to Prabhupada, and I was thinking, now here I am, the most fortunate person in the world, I'm walking next to Prabhupada. And I remember just so casually he turned and he looked at me, and he just gave me this look that turned me into dust. You know, it was just like, it wasn't any special effort for him, you know, but he just looked at me, and the way he looked at me, it made me realize that I was really, really nothing, you know. And then something interesting happened. This one non-devotee gentleman, he pushed his way right through the crowd, and he pushed himself right up in front of Prabhupada. More or less, he just stood right in Prabhupada's path, and he looked up and he said, Swami, I've got a question for you. And Prabhupada smiled very charmingly, and he said, what's your question? And the man said, if I were to give you $1 million right now, what would you do? And Prabhupada smiled and he said, oh, that's a very easy question. He said, I would print books and I would build beautiful temples for Krishna. And then the man just said, thank you very much, Swami. He turned and he walked off.
Prabhupada was always traveling economy class. So we got the bright idea that Prabhupada should travel first class. So we were going to Mauritius from Bombay. So I arranged for them to get first class seating for Prabhupada and his servant. And the rest of the party, they would fly economy. As it was, Prabhupada had me sit with him in the first class. So we're sitting there, and it's this huge seat. And then they come around to serve the meals. They have this trolley, and on the trolley is a big side of beef. And they're carving it to order. This is the luxury. Then they come around with the bar, with champagne and wine and liquor, and you know, everybody's drinking. So then Prabhupada asked for prasadam. They had packed, so we made a plate for Prabhupada and the flight attendants. They saw all the nice prasadam. They were curious as to what these things were. And Prabhupada just ate a very little bit. Then he said, oh, give to the flight attendants, because they were expressing interest. So we started giving them things, and oh, they loved it. They thought this was great. And they admitted that this food was much better. After we landed, Prabhupada called me in and said, you know, what is the value of flying this first class? I don't require a big seat. We don't eat their food. We don't drink their drinks. And you're paying, you know, whatever it is, twice the amount. So what is the use?
Srila Prabhupada is at the airport in the VIP lounge, sitting next to Gautam Tilak, who was our greatest well-wisher in Mauritius at that time, and another gentleman who is a member of parliament. Mr. Tilak also is a member of parliament. They were very eager to meet Srila Prabhupada at the airport. Actually, Mauritius is a little different from most other countries in the sense that it's one of the only countries in the world, like Nepal, India, governed by Indian Hindu majorities. So Srila Prabhupada knew about this. So he was specifically keen to come because he had heard some good reports about Mauritius when he was in India. And there was an invitation letter from the Prime Minister, Sir Siv Sagar Ramgulam, who invited Prabhupada to come and visit the island and grace it by his presence. So it was like very special.
Therefore, I'm trying to introduce this Krishna consciousness all over the world without any distinction of caste, creed, color. God is for everyone.
Mauritius was developed by two devotees. It's a small island off the east coast of Africa. Prabhupada said some very profound things in Mauritius. He was very serious with the young people who came to visit him. He didn't like the idea of dependence on a cash crop. Sugarcane was the cash crop. His comment to those young people was, the first duty of a nation is to become self-sufficient. And that was an extremely profound statement. Because if you look at the world situation and you look at so many of the trouble spots, it's all about trying to exploit somebody else's natural resources, like America and Europe trying to exploit the oil resources of other areas. And if each country would take that seriously, becoming self-sufficient, you know, you wouldn't have these major conflicts going on in the world. So when Prabhupada said that, it was extremely profound. When one asks, well, what is your movement doing to help the world? And he said, we're taking animals and turning them into human beings. And then he gave a very fiery lecture. And then at the end, he told Brahmananda, take the tape of this and send it to back to Godhead, and they should make an article out of this. The title of the article should be, first you make them human, then you talk about United Nations.
We were in Zambia in a little ashram, four of us sitting around, and one devotee there, his name was Bibakar. He was in the World Atlas looking at Africa and populations and whatnot. And he saw this little island out there in the middle of the Indian Ocean. He said, oh, look at it, it's like about 850,000 people. And more than half of them were Hindus. So Chaivana Maharaj and Parameshwari Das, they went to India for Maipur festival, and on their way back they stopped in Mauritius and they felt that it was a very nice place. So Bibakar and I went to Mauritius and we began things there. We kind of went there Prabhupada style. We went there with a trunk of books and more or less no money and an invitation to someone's house. That's how we began. The people took an immediate interest in us, I think just because we were a novelty. But the preaching really took off after Srila Prabhupada came. It's amazing to see the potency. I mean, he only stayed really a few days, and he inspired so many people. And the long-lasting effect of his presence is incalculable to me. I remember he was speaking so enthusiastically to a few boys that were coming, and they were talking about making that country the first Krishna conscious country, and I'm just sitting there thinking, this is never going to happen. But Srila Prabhupada, he could just see it. His devotion was so great that he literally influenced thousands of people, even though he only met a few.
The interesting thing about the place that where we were staying was that it was in an area that was mostly populated by Creole population, means Christians of African descent. And obviously they have never heard of Hare Krishna because it was such a new thing at that time. But when they heard a Swami, like a saintly person, was coming to reside in their neighborhood, and that there were going to be daily lectures in the evening, so many people came. So many ladies, young men, and all types of people, not only Hindus came. Actually, I would think the majority were non-Hindus, and they were all interested.
This house for Prabhupada to stay was given by Mr. Madhvani, who actually was the sugar king of Uganda, Madhvani Sugar Mills. We found out that Mauritius doesn't have a sugar refinery, that actually the sugar cane is crushed into juice, and then that's shipped to England, and it's refined in England. And then Mauritius has to buy sugar from England, although it's growing all the sugar cane. So Prabhupada was telling him, why are you providing sugar for the British, for their teacups? Just so that you get money, and then with the money, then you buy electronic goods. You have to import everything, because you're not making anything. And even food was imported. So Prabhupada said, instead of growing sugar cane, you should be growing your own food. Be self-sufficient in food. But you're just being exploited. You know, it goes back to the colonial times and the British Empire. Prabhupada didn't approve of cash crop. He approved of the food crop. So this was, you know, something revolutionary. Nobody ever told him this. And he told it also to the government officials that he met. This was part of the Krishna consciousness movement, to be self-sufficient. Be self-sufficient in food. So Prabhupada had been invited by the Prime Minister, Mr. Ram Gulam. So Prabhupada came. But then after arriving, the Prime Minister had some sudden engagements, and he had to postpone his meeting with Prabhupada. So one evening I had to make an international phone call, and I had to go to someone's house because we didn't have a phone. You had to book the call, and then they called you back. And while I was waiting on the TV, they showed the Prime Minister was inaugurating a chicken packing factory that had been built as a gift by the government of France. And it showed all these thousands of chickens and how they hang them by the head on these conveyor belts, and then this knife comes, and then the machine, you know, takes off all the feathers and then cuts it up, and out comes this, you know, packaged chicken. And there's Mr. Ram Gulam cutting the ribbon and how beneficial this will be. And I told Prabhupada what we saw on TV. Prabhupada said, "Oh, he is not Hindu." Prabhupada said, "I don't even want to meet him." Prabhupada was horrified. How could a Hindu person be giving this to his country? So Prabhupada didn't want to meet him, and so we canceled that.
So on one morning walk, we were going along the beach. It was very intimate because there were very few devotees in there, and Prabhupada was very relaxed. And in one place, Prabhupada was sitting on the bench. Pusa Krishna Maharaj put his chadar so that Prabhupada would be comfortable, and all the devotees were sitting down on the sand. And next to the bench, there was capsules of Coca-Cola, Pepsi-Cola, cigarette butts, and all kinds of wrappers. And then he said, "What is all this Pepsi-Cola, Coca-Cola? We don't use all this. What is the necessity of this Pepsi-Cola, Coca-Cola? In our ashram, we don't have any of this, and we are all very happy anyway." In this way, he said, they manufacture all kinds of things, and they make advertisements so that people will consume. In this way, they are misleading society into sense gratification. And because the people want sense gratification, they will purchase endlessly till finally, you know, they get sick of all this junk food and garbage.
Surrender unto Krishna in devotional service, in full Krishna consciousness, is the most confidential instruction and is the essence of the 18th chapter.
Because the body is born in America, therefore he's thinking
everything. One of the first things we arranged was a press conference. That's what we are seeing here. Prominent reporters from the television, the newspapers, were invited to come and meet Srila Prabhupada and put their questions. 1975 was a time when the country was not very developed and people were not very enlightened on spiritual subjects. The population of the country, consisting in a majority of Hindus, they were used more to Lord Shiva's worship and Ramayana. So to have Krishna being propagated was rather unusual. I remember when we came, we brought the Bhagavad Gita. And most people had just heard about the Bhagavad Gita, but very few people had it, the Bhagavad Gita actually at home. So there was such a big demand for the Bhagavad Gita as it is, that we couldn't supply because the yatra was not in any way up to the standard to import books from Los Angeles or anything like that. But anyway, we did take orders, and after some time, we were able to get the books in and distribute them to the people. So you see, the questions are rather simple. People here are generally quite accepting Swamis, priests, and other saintly persons without having to kind of challenge. Out of their cultural upbringing, they won't challenge him like a Western reporter would probably challenge him. We have recorded another exchange between the reporter and Prabhupada. The reporter is asking, "Do you think, Swamiji, that man can become perfect?" Prabhupada says that that is the chance of a human being. Therefore, in the human society, there are schools, colleges, education, culture, and not in the animal society. Humans can be made into perfect beings, not the animals. So if mankind is denied proper education, that is the greatest harm. Humans have got the opportunity for spiritual education, but the authorities are not giving them that opportunity. They're imperfect, and they are taking advice from the imperfect. Therefore, it's very difficult for them to understand, because they do not take advice from the perfect person, Krishna. Apashyatam atma tattvam. They cannot see. Without guidance from the Supreme Person, nothing can be properly managed. Then the reporter puts another question. Do you mean that perfection is to become God or to become a perfect man? Prabhupada says, man never becomes God. Then the reporter said, what does perfection mean? Prabhupada says, perfect means to become godly. So this was very significant, being also permeated by the impersonalist aspect of spirituality and by false teachings of Swamis, preachers, and other type of persons. They also had the idea maybe that if you become perfect, you become a god. But Prabhupada very clearly put it, man cannot become God, the best he can become godly.
There are degrees of light. There is sunlight and there is this light. You cannot compare this light with the sunlight. Light comes from everywhere. But that does not mean the sunlight and this light is the same. First of all, you understand this. You have question about the light. First of all, you understand there are degrees of light. You cannot say this light and the sunlight is the same.
By this you mean that those who adapt the life by the teachings coming from the Quran or from the Bible.
That is your business to study. But we give you the idea that light comes from everywhere. There is one glow-worm. That light also light. And the sunlight is also light. You cannot think that the glow-worm's light and the sunlight is the same. Now it is your business to see which is glow on light and which is sunlight. That is your business. Let them say all nonsense, what can I say? Every nonsense will speak something nonsense. How can I check it? There are so many nonsense, therefore we are trying to make all this nonsense into human being. That is our problem. So long he's on nonsense, he'll go on speaking nonsense. What can I do?
Swamiji, one thing I want to know. This slope, from where you have quoted this slope? This slope,
yes, it is in the third chapter of 12th canto of Srimad Bhagavat. Have you got all the Bhagavatas? 12th canto?
We don't
have it. So you can note it.
We'd rotate. Some of us stay back and clean Prabhupada's room or do personal services. So one day when I went on the walk, we were out approaching the beach. In the distance, a sugarcane truck goes by with four or five workers in the back of the truck. They saw us, and in a mocking way, they go, Hare Krishna, Hare Ram. they weren't nasty or anything. I mean, they're happy-go-lucky guys. And one of the devotees said, "Oh, Prabhupada, what happens to someone who chants Hare Krishna like that?" And Prabhupada said, in a very deep and most serious and convinced way, "They are liberated." So when he said that, I remember it reminded me of that verse in the first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. It goes, living entities who are, you know, in the meshes of birth and death can be freed immediately simply by chanting the name of Krishna, which is feared by fear personified. So I thought of those men and how, you know, Prabhupada said, well, they're liberated. But I'm sure they just took off and went to the sugarcane field and cut down some sugarcane and threw it in the truck and went and ate some lunch and went home and watched TV. And, you know, hard to see how they're liberated. But Prabhupada had that conviction, and that conviction is confirmed in Shastra. And we also have that kind of faith that Prabhupada doesn't just see things theoretically, but he sees through his realization. There was another thing that really struck me when we were on the beach, and I saw him do it also on the beach in Bombay, that total strangers would come up to him and he would greet them and just sort of beam at them. I mean, it's hard to describe in a way, like he's known him forever and is his best friend. But it was so disarming to see how much friendliness could come out of one person to, you know, a total stranger. From his angle, he could see everyone is part of God. He lives that or experiences that. Again, it's not just theoretical. And it comes out, and when you see it in his person, it's very astonishing.
We were going...
Hare Hare Krishna. I was called